church works, although it's a little lopsided, so I'm gonna... This is a strange day. Good morning. I am glad you are with us. I am glad it is bright and sunny in the sanctuary, because it's my favorite way to be in the sanctuary when you can feel the sunshine coming through. So, welcome. I'm gonna start off with a few announcements. Ron would like you all to know that the name tags are all newly situated in the name tag box. We had a lot of people who were in the name tag box who, for a variety of reasons, translate that how you will, are no longer with us. So your name tag will not be in the same spot in the name tag box. So if you used to be number 68, you might not be number 68 anymore. And if you think you should have a name tag and it's not in the name tag box, then you probably took it home or you lost it. That's what Ron says.
John's is in there.
John's is in there. Excellent. Excellent. All right, so poinsettias forms, our order forms for the poinsettias are due this week, November 14th. Form looks like this, it's in your bulletin. Or you can also find it online through the weekly email thing. So poinsettia forms due the 14th. Thank you. Hanging of the Greens will be after worship on November 19th. I believe that is next week. That's next week. Boy, we're just rolling right through this month of November. We are hosting our Maker's Market on November 18th. We could squeeze in another table, so if you know of any last-minute vendors, please have them let me or Sherry know early this week, because it is filling up. It's actually filled up, but we could squeeze in one more if we needed to. Okay. What, Sherry? There's always room for one more until we run out of tables. Our Advent Bible study will begin on November 28th. That's a Tuesday at 7 p.m. We meet Tuesday nights throughout Advent. If in-person meetings or Tuesday meetings don't work for you, there is an available session on Wednesday nights through Zoom with our friends in Connecticut. So if you would like to be on the Zoom Bible study, let me know, and I'll make sure that we get you on that list. The band book club is meeting on Wednesday, November 28th at 7 p.m. to discuss Eleanor and Park, and we'd love to have you join us. There's still time to get the book and read it. So, and last but not, I have two last announcements. All blended together. Also in your bulletin is the pledge card, because we are in the midst of stewardship season. We will take your pledge card anytime you want to give it to us, but it would be lovely if you considered turning it in by next week. Just an option. And Advent devotionals are available as books for our Advent season. We also have them as an ebook if you prefer digital reading. They are free for anyone who wants one, but if you would like to help offset the print costs, they are beautiful, printed in color, beautiful artwork in them. $5 is the suggested cost that it charges us to print them. So, just let me know if you want one of those, and we'll make sure that you get what you need. Those are our announcements. As always, we light our candles. As a reminder that God's light shines in even the darkest of corners. Let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship with the music of the prelude. Thank you.
Please stand if you are able and join me in the call to worship. God of abundant grace called Jonah long ago.
God of abundant grace calls us today.
God called Jonah to share the good news of God's grace.
God is calling us to share the good news of God's grace.
Come.
Despite our fears.
Come.
Despite our desires to run away.
Come.
Despite our worries that we are not enough.
Come.
Let us worship the one who calls us.
Our opening hymn is number 72, There's a Wideness to God's Mercy.
Has anybody ever heard the word pericope? Let's see see if they have. Has anybody ever heard the word pericope? Yeah, I think you have an advantage, though. A pericope is an extract from a text, so sort of like a paragraph in a bigger book. And a lot of times that's what we read here on Sunday mornings, because we don't read the whole Bible, right? Thank goodness, right? Okay, but today we're not doing that. Today we're not going to hear pericope. Are you worried? I am a little. This morning we're going to read the entire book of Jonah. Who's afraid? John's only afraid because he's my helper. The book of Jonah, though, is one of the shortest books. It's only 4 chapters. Do you know how many books are in the book of Isaiah, which I almost picked? 66. I thought, we'll read that book. Too long, right? Way too long. Way too long. So, have you ever heard of Jonah? Anybody? We've got a few. All right. Have you heard of Jonah? Who's Jonah? You don't. But you've heard of him. Okay. So, Jonah is a prophet. Who knows what a prophet is? Anybody? What's a prophet?
Like, someone who God gives the ability to, like, kind of like Moses, like, someone who's really special?
Yeah. So a prophet is somebody that, kind of like Moses, who's really special. Prophets are people who kind of help the rest of us know what God is thinking, God is doing, and helps us to see the world in a big picture. That's a really good answer. So, Jonah was a prophet when God said, hey, Jonah, I need you to go do something for me. Jonah said, no. And he tried to run away, and guess what happened? He got stuck in a fish for 3 days. Isn't that crazy? Yeah. So then he got out of the fish, you know, and then, so like Jonah got, he was a prophet, and he got a little scared because he didn't want to go where God was sending him, so he ran in the opposite direction because God wanted him to go to Nineveh, which is a city, and Jonah was like, but the people in Nineveh are mean. Would you want to go where people are mean? No, me either. So he was like, I'm going to go, like Nineveh was to the east, and Jonah's like, I'm going to go west. And God said, no. So he put Jonah in a fish, and Jonah was like, okay, I don't really like being in a fish. So if it's stay in the fish or go to Nineveh, I'll go to Nineveh, right? Would you go to Nineveh or would you stay in the fish? Right. What would you do? You would go to Nineveh too? That's smart. We could ask Sherry and David if they'd rather go to Lansing or stay in a fish, because they don't like to go to Lansing. They like Ann Arbor. What do you think they would do? She says fish. So Jonah gets to Nineveh, and he tells the people of Nineveh what God wants them to know. And then, do you think God is nice to the people of Nineveh? He is. How do you think that makes Jonah feel?
Happy.
No, it doesn't make Jonah happy. It makes Jonah mad. Because Jonah thinks that God should be mad at the people of Nineveh too. Do you ever have that happen where your siblings do something wrong and your parents are nice to them, but you're like, hey, yep, nods. She got an uh-huh. So Jonah's kind of crabby about that, and he isn't sure if that was the right thing. Anybody can relate to Jonah? Me too. I don't like to go to a place where there are scary people, and I sometimes get crabby if I think that people who are mean are getting good things, and you know, I don't like it when things are unfair, and I get crabby when things are unfair. Anybody else? Yeah, it's because we're human. These are really hard things, though, that God kind of wants us to do all the time. He wants us to be nice to people, even if they're mean to us. And sometimes God says, go somewhere and you don't want to go. Like, you don't want to go to new scary places, right? I like to go to places I know about. Are you brave enough to go to scary places? You went to a place you've never been to before? It was Florida? That is a scary place. That's pretty brave of you. So God tells us to do things all the time. We have lots of rules that we're supposed to follow. And raise your hand if you get it right sometimes. Yeah, everybody gets it right sometimes. Raise your hand if you get it wrong sometimes. Yeah, me too. So, now we're going to get ready to hear the whole story of Jonah. Who's excited to hear the entire story of Jonah? Okay, excellent. I'm excited about this. But before we do that, we're going to pray. Everybody ready? Holy and wise God, help us to remember that we are all people and that you created us in your image and that you love all of us. Help us to be brave enough to go where you send us. Help us to find ways to give and show love in all places and to all people, especially when it's hard. Amen. Amen. The book of Jonah, as read in a theatrical way as we could possibly do. One day, the word of the Eternal One came to the prophet Jonah.
Get up and go to that powerful and notorious city of Nineveh. Call out my message against it, because the wickedness of its people has come to my attention.
In hearing those instructions, Jonah got up and ran towards Tarshish. From the Eternal One's presence, he went down to the port at Joppa and found a ship bound for Tarshish, and he climbed aboard it, paid the fare, and made himself comfortable in the hold of the ship. Not to be deterred, the Eternal One threw an intense wind at the sea. The violence of the storm put Jonah's ship in jeopardy of breaking apart. The sailors panicked. They started running back and forth, throwing cargo overboard to lighten the boat. Every man, out of desperation, cried to his own deity. Eventually, a sailor found Jonah down in the hold of the ship, where he had lain down and fallen into a deep slumber. When the captain heard, he went down and woke Jonah up.
How can you sleep so deeply? Get up and call out to your deity. Maybe your deity will see what is happening and save us from this catastrophe.
The sailors, in their fear and desperation, came up with an idea.
You know what we should do? We should cast lots to find out who is ultimately responsible for our distress.
So they cast lots, and Jonah's name was chosen. Turning to Jonah, they cried,
Who are you? We must know who is responsible for this disaster that would swallow us in the sea. What do you do? Where are you from? What country is your home? Whom are you descended from?
And he answered them,
I am Hebrew, and the God whom I worship is the Eternal One, the God of heaven. He made the sea and the land, so he controls them.
After interrogating him, the sailors were terrified, because Jonah had told them he was running away from the Eternal's presence.
What have you done? Because of you, we're all going to be killed. What should we do to make the sea calm down for us?
And again he answered,
God is using the sea to punish me, so pick me up and throw me into the sea. Then the sea will grow calm again, and you'll be safe. This is all my fault. This great storm of my God's anger is built against you because of me.
The sailors ignored Jonah's advice and tried to row back to land. They made no headway because the violence of the storm kept growing.
Eternal One, please, we beg you, do not kill us as if we had murdered this man, and don't punish us as if we killed an innocent person. We understand that you, Eternal One, do as you please.
After that, they grabbed Jonah by his arms and legs and threw him overboard. And when they did, the raging sea grew calm. The sailors were even more terrified of the Eternal One. They offered sacrifices to him and made promises to him. The Eternal didn't let Jonah die. He chose a large fish to swallow Jonah. For 3 days and three nights, Jonah sat safely inside the belly of this fish. And to his God, the Eternal, Jonah prayed from inside this great fish.
With desperate cries, I beckoned the Eternal to hear, and he answered me. From the belly, the place of death, I cried out to you, and you have responded to my voice. You threw me into the watery depths and cast me into the middle of the chaotic seas. The waters closed in around me. Your waves broke over me. Your surf swelled as I sank into the depths. But then I said to you, I've been driven out from before your very eyes. Still, I know I will gaze again on your holy temple. The waters swallowed me. The deep abyss was covering me. Seaweeds were wrapped around my head, trapping me. As I sank down to where the mountains are rooted to the earth, I went down to the place where death's gate would lock me forever. Yet you lifted me up from the pit. Eternal One, you are my God. Only as my life was fading did I remember the Eternal to you. To your sacred dwelling, your holy temple, my cries did rise to you. Those who worship worthless idols turn their backs on God and renounce their loyal love. But I will sing to you and sacrifice to you with a voice filled with thanksgiving. Whatever I promised, I will certainly pay it, because deliverance is from the Eternal alone.
Then the Eternal One directed the fish, and it vomited Jonah onto the shore. The word of the Eternal came to the prophet Jonah a second time.
Get up and go to that powerful and notorious city of Nineveh, and pass on to them the message I'm giving you.
Having learned his lesson, Jonah yielded to the Eternal's command and headed on the road to Nineveh. Now Nineveh was an important city so large that it took 3 days to travel throughout it. And Jonah had barely begun to walk the first day's journey to the city when he stopped.
After 40 days, Nineveh will be annihilated.
With that announcement, the people of Nineveh started to trust in Jonah's God. Every person, whether young or old, rich or poor, male or female, fasted and wore a sack as a sign of remorse for his past wickedness. The people of Nineveh told each other about this until the news made it all the way to the king of Nineveh, who ruled the entire Assyrian Empire. The king changed from his royal robes to sackcloth, and instead of sitting high up on his throne, he sat down low in the dust. He sent an official message to his subjects.
By order of the king of Nineveh and his nobles, no human being, animal, cattle, or flock may taste anything. None of them may go out to eat or drink any water. Instead, let humans and animals cover themselves with sacks. Let all who belong to this empire call to God sincerely and turn from their wicked ways and violent acts. Perhaps Jonah's God will show mercy and relent from his judgment. Perhaps out of compassion, he will not unleash his fierce anger against us, and we may be spared.
God saw all that they did and how they had turned from their evil ways, so he relented and decided not to unleash the disasters he said he would through his servant Jonah. The mercy God extended toward Nineveh upset Jonah terribly. The more he thought about it, the angrier he became. So he prayed to the Eternal.
Eternal One, isn't this what I said would happen when I was still in my own country? This is exactly the reason I ran to Tarshish in the first place. I know how you are. I know that you are not like other gods, that you are full of grace and compassion, that it takes a lot to make you angry, and that your loyal love is so great that you are always ready to relent from inflicting misery. Eternal One, since you didn't kill them, please take my life away from me, for my death now is so much better than my life tomorrow.
The Eternal One answered him.
Jonah, do you have any good reason to be angry?
Jonah headed east out of the city and instead of west toward his home to look for a hot place high above the city to sit down. He found a suitable spot and built shelter from the hot sun. He sat there waiting to see what might happen to the city. Then the Eternal God chose a gourd plant to grow up and shade Jonah from the discomfort of the intense heat. The large, thick leaves of this vine made Jonah very, very happy. But at dawn the next day, God chose a worm to chew through the gourd's line, and that night it shriveled. Then, when the sun rose, God chose a scorching east wind to blow as the sun beat down from the cloudless sky on Jonah's head. He became faint, and again he asked to die.
My death now is so much better than my life tomorrow.
And God answered him,
Do you have any good reason to be angry about this gourd's vine?
With frustration and anger, Jonah answered God,
Yes, I do. I'm angry enough to die.
And once again, God replied,
Jonah, don't you understand? You care about this gourd's vine, and yet you didn't do anything to make it grow. You didn't plant it, water it, or protect it. It appeared one night, then died another. Should I not have pity on that great city of Nineveh, where there are more than 120,000 people who do not know their right hand from their left, and also many animals?
The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
back in the middle of our stewardship campaign, so it makes perfect sense that I choose this Sunday to talk about the greatest of all prophets, Jonah. If ever there was a poster child for a good stewardship campaign, it's Jonah. Okay, that's not true. It's not Jonah. In fact, Jonah is not the greatest prophet. He's not even really all that generous. And there really isn't a whole lot of stewardshipy imagery in the story of Jonah, with one pretty significant exception. But we're going to get to that in a minute. There's no talk of human generosity. There are not purses overflowing with monies or baskets upon baskets of food. But there is God's abundant grace. Here's the problem and the gift of Jonah. We are so much like Jonah. Jonah is cranky and reluctant. And he's kind of short-sighted. But I like him. I really like Jonah. I like Jonah because he is imperfect. He is full of humanness. Jonah does just about everything he can think of to get out of doing what God has asked, to the point he goes in the opposite direction and spends time in a fish. But Jonah's actually really good at doing what God has asked of him. We all heard what he said to the people of Nineveh, and if Jonah showed up in our community today, we would probably talk about him on the Overheard in Manistee Facebook page and not actually do anything he said. We would do that. But Jonah managed to get an entire city full of people who had zero reason to trust Jonah to change their ways. Jonah, perhaps in spite of himself, is actually changing lives.